sure by now, God, you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I'll say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I'll barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, you hold in your hands. You never left my side, though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I remember when I stumbled in the wind, you heard my cry, you raised me up again. My strength is almost gone, how can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in the storm, I will lift my hands, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm. I lift my eyes up to the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, Maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes up to the hills, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the Maker of heaven and earth. And I'll praise you in the storm, for you are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I've cried, you hold in your hands. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in the storm.
All right, wonderful. Glad to have you come to our service here at Elkview Baptist Church. And this is a beautiful Saturday afternoon while we're recording. I know you're going to be watching on Sunday morning, but man, just a gorgeous day. Thankful for the sunshine, aren't you? You know, we got some exciting things happening, even in the midst of a pandemic. And Pastor Hank, I was just so thankful for him this week. He was able to secure 4 food drives in a row, one a month, that are going to be happening right off our church parking lot. At the end of May, you'll see that roll out. At the end of June, just every month. And that's so awesome and just so grateful for the work that he is doing. Also, our adult Bible fellowship classes. Just want you to be aware of some of the things going on. You see this slide? Clay Cafe. Our post-high school and college students meet, and there's a contact email. If you would like to join that online discussion, please do so. And then we have another option for you. And we'll have it up on the screen there in just a second, but we've got different adult Bible fellowship classes that you can participate in. All right, there's our next one. Richard and Mary Jane Cole leading the Explore the Bible class. And, you know, maybe you've not been involved in ABF up to this point. Please email them. There's their contact information. And you can get zoomed right into that discussion. We've got two more to show you here. The Upper Room. I'm so thankful for Ben Ellis and the class there he teaches. And notice the email contact that get part of that Bible study. And then the last one we're offering right now is Brother Lane Ellis, Berean Bible class. Now you can view Lane's class from our main website under the Ministries tab, because he comes right into Sanctuary and records right here. So it's exciting to me that we've got all these options being rolled out, and they're going to be there a while, folks, because we're not fully through this pandemic, are we? Also, this week we're collecting food for our partners with Vision Appalachia. You know Jesse Boggs, we all love him. You can freeze frame your this slide right here. Those are the items he's looking for to be dropped off here at the church by May 7th. And that'll be put together in packets and supporting people down in Clay County with the food distribution. And yet we've got four food distributions scheduled at the end of every month right here from our church parking lot. So a lot of ministry happening at this time. I've got one more big announcement, and then we're going to get our service started with prayer. We have Pastor Dan Forwood coming to pray. Now here's the big announcement. Pastor Hank was watching the governor's website. He released the specific guidelines, a two-page document for churches to reopen. And we have that in hand. We just received it this week. And we have set our target date for reopening 1 week later than permissible. We're pushing it back just a little bit. And the governor's got 12 wonderful best practices that are giving guidance to churches. We had 10 of them already in our plan before we even saw the governor's guidance. So our deacons are meeting next week, okay, on the 12th. We're going to finalize our plan. We'll be mailing all of you in our database a letter as to how the reopening will work, what's going to be offered, what's not. And look, God willing, we're going to reopen on May 24th with services here. But there are a great many of you that definitely will need to continue to view from home online for a while longer. And look, we want you to do that. But we will go ahead and, God willing, start to reopen while also offering the online services. Isn't that awesome? Amen. Our Father's walking us through this thing. Now, Pastor Dan's coming, and he's going to be leading us for a moment.
Wow, such wonderful news. Just 3 weeks, and we can come together safely and make a joyful sound to the Lord. I know many of you are like me, have just been waiting to get back in church, to fellowship, and to serve, to just worship the Lord. So that gives us something to look forward to. Before Pastor Charles gives his message, let's have a word of prayer, if you would. Let us pray. Father, we humbly come before you again this day to ask your blessings and for your will to be done in each situation we face. Though many things may look ominous and even fearful in the world today, we as Christians have your promise in Romans 8:28 that says all things work good for the good for those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And Father, because of our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, we know that you are our Father and that we can call you Abba, which signifies our standing as a child of the Most High. Lord, we cast our fear on you, Lord, knowing that as the psalmist wrote in Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. And Father, even though we need not fear, we do pray for those who are suffering throughout this world. Father, we continue to pray for an end to this COVID-19 virus. We continue to pray for safety for those essential workers, for those hospital workers, for those in the nursing homes, for those in-home caregivers and our first responders. Lord, we pray that you stop the spread of this horrible disease, that you heal those that are sick now, that you comfort those who have lost a friend or a loved one, that you provide a vaccine and medication to combat this horrible disease. And Father, we lift up our leaders to you and pray that you give them discernment as to how and when to open up our country for business once again. We pray, Father, that people could get back to work safely, that businesses, small and large, would not only open, but they would succeed and that our economy would grow. And Father, we pray for our church and our church families. We wait for our coming together here in just 3 weeks to come together in fellowship to praise and worship you through the music and through the testimonies and through the messages we receive in this sanctuary. We pray for the needs of our church family, Father, for those that are dealing with illness, for those who are dealing with recovery, and even those that have dealt with job loss. We pray for all of our ministries to become active once again. And Father, we truly do give praise and thanks for Pastor Charles and Pastor Cliff for the wonderful messages that we've heard during this period. We pray that we are drawing closer to you, Lord, through our time at home, through spending more time in prayer and more time in our Bibles. But Father, most of all, we pray that you receive the glory through this pandemic by our actions. We pray that our faithfulness will be seen by all, that our compassion towards others will grow. And we pray for our love for you and others to be manifested in all that we do and say. Now, Father, we pray that you'll bless Pastor Charles as he delivers this message, and may our hearts be open to receive it. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
There we go. Am I there now? All right. Sorry about that, folks. I invite you to open your Bibles to Matthew 14, and we are continuing our series of messages, Navigating a National Crisis. And this morning, the title is The Storms of Life. You know, for the last few weeks, we've been talking about a nation that's been having a crisis. We looked at Israel and some of their circumstances in millennia gone by. But we even looked at their collective response to a national crisis. But this morning, I'd like to look at our personal response during a time of crisis. Just us personally, what we need to choose. So before I read the text, I want to stimulate some thinking with asking a question. Here it is. Does obedience to Christ indicate that life's circumstances will be good? Does obedience to Christ indicate that life's circumstances will be good? Now, to help answer that question, I want to tell you a story that Aaron Talbert grew up in this church, was saved in this church, and went out as a missionary to China for a number of years from this church. He now is a pastor over in the state of Indiana, and many of you know Aaron Talbert. He told this story. He said that a Chinese lady in the government education system was being given a promotion, and he knew this lady personally. The promotion would have been the pinnacle of her career. It was the top slot for her. She was asked prior to, the promotion coming into play, she was asked to sign a statement of faith, swearing allegiance to the communistic government and denying the validity of faith in Christ. Now, this is just a few years old, this story. And instead of the promotion, she was dismissed altogether, lost her job. So the question is, does obedience to Christ indicate that life circumstances will be good? And of course, we see the answer is no. You know, what we are guaranteed in this life is the presence of our Savior, our Father's love, and His abiding care and concern. We are guaranteed His presence, and we are guaranteed the security of our soul. Man, we got some guarantees, but they're not related to circumstances. Now, let me give you the context of Matthew 14, and I'm excited about rolling out this message, but let me give you the context before we read the text. What's happened already in Matthew 14? John the Baptist, he was obedient to Christ, and he lost his head. No, I don't mean he had a fit of anger. I mean he lost his head. It was taken up from him. Herod had him executed. And Jesus and the disciples went and collected John's lifeless body, and they buried him that day. And what a heavy weight weighed on these men's mind. And then they walked along the edge of Galilee. They had already buried a dear friend. And they're trying to find some solace, some solitude. Jesus knows those men, those 12 men, need to be ministered to. And this is all in the early part of chapter 14. They get in a boat to get away from people following them, and they just do a little hop, skip, jump down the shoreline to just a short distance down, and the people follow along. By the time they reach the shore again, no sooner than they're off the boat, there's a crowd gathered around, and that's where Jesus' heart is moved with compassion, and the Father is guiding right then and there. Show these men how even when they're worn down and frazzled and at the end of their rope, that they can still be energized by the Spirit and do much. And they fed 5,000 people on the hillside that evening that heard Jesus preach. So they've had an emotional day. They've had a physically draining day. And now it's starting to sunset, and Jesus is like, disciples, get in the boat and cross the Sea of Galilee this time. Go all the way across. I'll join you later. Let me send the people away. So that's where our reading begins. In verse number 22, the Bible says, immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat. He made them and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Now when the evening came, he was alone there. Solitude, mountaintop, Jesus in prayer to the Father. But the boat was now in the middle of the sea, tossed by the waves, for the wind was contrary. Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a ghost!" And they cried out for fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Hey, be of good cheer! It is I. Do not be afraid." But Peter answered Jesus and said, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." And when Peter had come down out of the boat, He walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when Peter saw that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, Peter cried out, saying, "Lord, save me!" And immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those who were in the boat came and worshiped Jesus, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." Well, storms aren't interruptions to be avoided. They're more than that. In the storms of life, there are some fundamental questions that have to be grappled with, and that's where our clearest convictions get formed, in the storms. You know, if you think about this, God allows circumstances like stormy nights. I mean, it was Jesus that said, he said to the disciples, "Get into that boat, cross over, I'll be joining you later." And the Son of God full well knew what the disciples faced. He knew they would face it being physically tired, being emotionally tired. They'd had that long day, a long evening of ministry, and a stormy journey. Do you know the point that they disembarked from and the point that they did arrive with Jesus later was 3.3 miles apart, but they had already been rowing at the oars for 7 to 8 hours. This was excruciating. Think of the emotional strain these men were under. What did their future hold? John the Baptist, they had received his body without its head. They had laid him to rest. And their minds are swirling as to what their futures would look like. Why does God allow circumstances like this? Why did God? That's the question that gets answered in the midst of storms. Why does God allow circumstances like this? You know, friend, God is not weak to deliver precious personal encounters and precise personal victories during a time of crisis. We've been talking about what nations can do in the time of crisis. Well, what about God's people? What about you and me? Precious encounters with him and strong personal victories. You know, the whys of a crisis, those questions, they're so appropriate that we wrestle through those. You know, there's another question. Where is God in the midst of the storms of life? You know, where is God in the midst of a pandemic? We've heard people asking. You know, one person said that God and timing, when it comes to God's timing, he is seldom early, but never late. And, you know, even that may generate strife and strain in our hearts. And I'm not saying that's inspired, but I'm saying I have found it to be personally trustworthy that God is seldom early in a storm. But I can testify he's never been late. I would not charge him with that. You know, the men set sail from the Sea of Galilee on the bank there, somewhere around sunset. Depending on the time of year, that would have fell between 6 and 7 p.m. in the evening. And then they strained and struggled as they got kind of mid-sea. They strained and struggled in the middle of the night, through the middle of the night. It says at the fourth watch of the night. Well, friends, that's the final run-up to daybreak. The fourth watch of the night is the fourth quarter of the night. That starts at 3 a.m. and runs to 6 a.m. And somewhere in that span of time, Jesus comes walking on the water. So I'm trying to point out to you, there was a stormy situation for a period of time. What was God's men doing during that time? We know they were rowing. We know they were bailing water. But is there evidence that points to them doing something else? What weren't they doing during that storm? I want to point out about God's timing. Where is God? I want to tell you, He is nigh unto all those that call out to him of a broken and contrite heart. He is here. Hallelujah. He is here. Amen. And in his time, he makes all things beautiful in his time. And everything in the believer's life is worked through, not to destroy, but it's worked through for our good. He makes all things beautiful in his time. Lord, please show me every day that you're teaching me your way, and you do just what you say in your time. Well, you know, Jesus appeared to them on the water. And guess what? They didn't recognize Jesus. That is stunning. That is shocking. Because I perceive Jesus was the only one on the mountaintop alone in prayer. He was up there alone with the Father. He was ready for life, ready for ministry, ready for crisis, ready for the storm. And here you've got those precious disciples, me and you. There we are. We're in the midst of life's storm. We're doing the hardest, best thing we know to do. And Jesus is standing right there in front of us, and we can't recognize his presence. I see an analogy there. I trust you've picked up on it already. Listen, friends, I don't think they were doing the right amount of expectation in that boat. I don't think they had prayed in expectation, believing Jesus' arrival. I don't think they had prayed expectantly that the Father had an interest in their toil. I don't think they were there yet. I think their faith was weak. Oh, we know a lot more now, don't we? We've got a lot more examples in the printed Word of God, don't we? You know, God shows up quicker when we call out sooner. Hallelujah! That's why we've been fasting for 2 weeks on Wednesdays. God shows up quicker when we call out sooner. Now, a little aside here. This Thursday is the National Day of Prayer. I'm so glad that our nation, and we have an administration that emphasizes there is a National Day of Prayer. Whether they emphasize it or not, we can observe it. So let's move our day of fasting and prayer from Wednesday this week. Let's move it on to Thursday. And we'll do the exact same practice. If you are physically able to participate in a partial fast or whole fast, set aside Thursday. The church doors will open at 9 in the morning and be open to close at 5 that day. We'll use the same system of security coming in and safety. You pick up a marker at the main entrance. You place it in the sanctuary. You just enjoy the presence of the Lord. Pray, and enjoy the church house. And then go on your way, leaving your marker right here. No one else will use the space you use. So I would say to you that storms are not interruptions to avoid. They are lessons to embrace. And that brings me to my second point. Let's look quickly at the lessons to embrace. Let's learn more about, during the storms of life, let's learn more about the presence of Jesus. In verse number 27, the Bible says, Jesus said, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Do not be afraid." He's hearkening out over the storm's roar. Hey, folks, don't be afraid. I'm in sight. I'll tell you what, he may be just beyond that cloud, just beyond that nice springtime cloud. He may be a lot closer than we think, but I want to tell you, in the form of his spirit in the form of grace and strength and courage and all the fruits of the Holy Spirit. He is here. Hallelujah. He's here now. Let's learn to enjoy the presence of Jesus in the midst of the storm. Do you know what joy means more during adversity than it does during pleasure? Joy has the greatest potential to impact your life, to build your faith, to break down bad habits in your heart. Joy has more ability to be impactful on others when circumstances are at their worst. James told us in that pastoral epistle of James, he said, brothers and sisters, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Listen, we can learn the presence of Jesus and bring joy right into the midst of a national pandemic. And you know what else we learn in the presence of Jesus is confidence. Confidence. You know, I mean, we need not be paralyzed, and we need not worry incessantly. We can have confidence because where Jesus is, there's not going to be a spirit of fear. He dispels that spirit. We are told to come boldly into the throne room and find grace and mercy in the time of need. And that's where we're at, folks, in the midst of a storm. We learn the presence of Jesus better, and then we learn to practice our faith more consistently in the midst of the storm. Now, this, obviously, you can't preach on Jesus walking on water and Peter getting out of the boat and walking on water. You can't do that without talking about let's exercise our faith. So let's advance the slide to practicing our faith. There we go. Let me make a comment right here. Our personal walk of faith has its ups and downs. I don't care how solid, how principled, how spiritual we are with our devotional practice. Every person's practice of faith has its ups and downs. And here we see this man named Peter. He has some ups. His eyes see the Lord Jesus out there on the billowing waves. And his heart aspires to know what the will of God is. He wasn't even presumptuous here. He said, Lord, if you command me, I'll do this. So his heart aspires to know God's will. And then his will chooses to step out of that boat in obedience to what Jesus said to do. Wow. Peter saw the Lord. He inquired of the Lord. He started out in obedience. Can you see him going across those waves? He's saying, I'm obeying, Jesus. I'm obeying. And here he's going. But our personal walk of faith, no matter how spiritually minded we may be, we have our ups and our downs. Because his eye began to focus on the circumstance of the strength of the wind, the height of the waves, and emotion began to dominate his heart at that moment, and his obedience got distracted, and Peter began to sink. Oh my goodness. Oh, when a Christian has an up and a down in their faith and they began to sink, sorry, you're gone. I guess you're just, you know, see in heaven. That's not how it goes. Our Father has never operated that way. He knows the frailty. He cares. He loves. He understands the betrayal of our emotions, the fickleness of our choices. And not to excuse foolishness on our part or sin, but he understands the vacillations of our mind when it comes to walking by faith, and not at all. Immediately, this brother that had tried to walk by faith is helped. And he is spared the absolute worst he could have experienced. He is spared that. So I say, in the midst of a storm, we learn the provisions of mercy. The provisions of mercy. That's what we can learn right now. Is God is merciful to his children. He is merciful to the humble. If you're going to ever think that God is harsh and indignant and angry, There's only one characteristic in the Bible that consistently you can see the Father being that. And it is on the proud, obstinate heart. God gives us storms or allows storms, and in the midst of the storms, we can learn more about how merciful He is. Listen, friend, I want to tell you, I'm excited about this next verse. Because this phrase occurs 41 times in the Bible. 41 times. That repetition is inspired, and it should shout a megaphone at you and me. And here it is. Let those who fear the Lord now say. Do you have the fear of the Lord on your heart? Do you have a reverence toward your Creator? Do you have a understanding and an affection toward the Son of God, Jesus Christ? Let those who fear the Lord now say, here it is, His mercy endures forever. Oh, wow. I don't care what kind of faltering you've had. I don't care what kind of failure you've had. I don't care if you've started to sink down in despair and dismay. I want to tell you right now, His mercy endures forever to the heart that is reverenced and feared toward Him. Lord, save me! Boom, it's done. He's right there, lifting you up. You know, sometimes we are so black and white in our thinking. We're so rigid. We're so brutal. We think, well, he should have never got out of the boat to start with. What is that idiot doing? He should have stayed in the boat. Do you really think Jesus would have rather Peter stayed in the boat? Jesus said to Peter, come. You're learning how to use your faith. Come. Walk by faith. Look, my friend, when we've got direct obedience to Jesus in view, okay, then what we're doing is not foolishness, it's faith, okay? Jesus was delighted that Peter got out of the boat and he exercised his faith. And Jesus was also delighted to save Peter's life. Now, I'd like to make a little analogy, a little application off to the side. I don't want to overemphasize this point, but we're about to get out of the boat and start walking by faith as a nation. We're starting to reopen certain sections of the country that are not hot spots. All right, we're starting to get ready to reopen in the state of West Virginia. Hospitals start this next week ahead, and then I understand churches follow the week after that, and we've set our opening for even a week after that. And listen, friends, no man-made plan is going to be flawless. People are dying. Our hearts are tender. Our prayers are sincere. There's no perfect plan. But let's not let our lives be faithless. Okay, there's going to be a time where our Father says to us, with clear conscience and all best practices in place, it's time to step out by faith. Now, we're all going to get there at different times. We're going to have different permission limits. And I want you to know right now, Elkview Baptist Church is going to follow every order that comes, except that order contradict God's word himself, you know, God's word itself. We'll follow every order. And we're looking at every best practice and pondering hard how to bring them to bear here. There is a difference by best practice and order. And we are going to endeavor to practice it all correctly. But I want to tell you, no man-made plan will avoid all pain. We are not in heaven yet. So let's be praying for one another. Let's be supportive of one another. Let's not be quick to judge one another. And let's support one another. And we have been. And I'm proud of that. So I come to my final point. The storms of life can teach us a point of truth. A point of truth. Because once Peter and Jesus got onto the boat, the storm was dispelled. And the disciples gathered around Jesus in awe and wonder. And they said, "Truly, you are the Son of God." You know, what point of truth could we be learning in this pandemic? I suspect there's several things God's drilling down in our hearts. So I conclude with this thought. Storms aren't interruptions. They can be instruments of the Lord. Now I'm going to pray for you. And before I pray, I just want to ask you to consider these questions. This is the last slide on the screen. And as these are lessons from the storm, and we are in a storm of life. We're all in it together here, this big pandemic. And yet that generates different kinds of storms. There's financial storms going on. There are health storms going on. All kinds of storms in our personal lives. And I want to ask you if you would discuss one of these questions with someone there in your space this morning. Am I recognizing the presence of Jesus in the storms of life? Is my faith muscle being exercised? And tell the person about that. It is being, or it needs to be exercised. Have I sunk into despair and need to cry out for mercy? I'll tell you, if we could admit that to somebody sitting next to us, I want to tell you, the Father will start, he'll start that mercy flowing right then and there. You'll feel it. You'll know it. What truth am I learning in this storm? So those are our application questions. Don't run away from the service too quickly. Be transparent. Let's get the benefit of the storm. Would you let me pray for us now? Our Father, you have allowed the storms of life increase our expectation of you to calm our storm. Settle our inner man with your presence. Father, for the one that needs to cry out, "Lord, save me," oh, may they cry it with clarity, with certainty, and in such a way that it saves their eternal soul. Father, if they just need to be saved from a moment of doubt and despair, may they cry it out in a way that they know you've mercifully reached down and you're now changing their minds. So, Lord, we would just thank you for showing us an example of a storm that you were so ready to show up. Help us recognize you working in our midst. Be with us during the National Day of Prayer on Thursday. Father, strengthen our hearts in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, God bless you and have a great discussion. Thank you.